Today's episode of After the Previews is brought to you by
Audible.com.
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 Over 180,000 titles to choose from on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, MP3 player. Kyle, when was the last time you read a book?
Dude, I think I read like 3 pages out of a book in March this year.
Now tell me this. When was the last time you listened to something?
I listen to something every day.
Exactly, Kyle.
I'm on
that
a
is
podcast
why,
network.
That is why Audible is your number one source. Go over to audibletrial.com/constantrotation. That will get you one free audiobook download and a free 30-day free trial to try it all out. No questions asked. Cancel at any time. What do you think about that, Kyle?
That sounds awesome. And because like I'm pretty sure you get to keep the book too, right?
Yes.
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 Oh.
Yes. The book is yours. No questions asked. Audible is the place. Audible is the plug. Hey, Kyle.
I'm going to experience a book, and I don't even have to read it.
This is the last time we will ever read!
Yeah! Down with reading! Down with reading!
Hey, guys. Interrupting your podcast here to bring you a fucking ad in your face, in your ears, from the wonderful place of blueberry.com, blueberry.com. That is where you'll get all your podcast hosting, podcast statistics, or if you just need a PowerPress plugin, or you could just go through full PowerPress sites, get it all in one location, one solution, seamless integration with WordPress. Exceeding your monthly storage is not a problem with blueberry.com. You will just get your overage included in the one price that you pay every single month. Replace your archive for free. Print your export. Print everything. Just get it everywhere. Pass it out to your homies. Pass it out to your grandma. Pass it out to your mom. Pass it out to your dog. Just get everything out there. But Blueberry will let you do that just for one price. Go over there. Hit order now on the homepage. Go over to the promo code. Type in variable. VARIABLE. That is variable, our promo code. It'll get you one free month of premium subscriptions from blueberry.com. Shout out to them. Thank you for sponsoring this podcast. If I had to do a poll of like what's the worst day of the week, Josh, what would you say?
Monday.
But like can I get a little bit of a, like a fuck Monday? Can we all do it together? 1, 2, 3, fuck Monday.
Well, I think Monday would lose in the pool, but personally I like it.
Josh, what I'm here to tell you is that Mondays are music oriented. Music Mondays.
That's why I like them.
Ah, dude, there we go. Where do you go? You go to soundcloud.com/constantrotation and get into that.
Where else would you go?
I don't know, but that is the place where you should be. 8 a.m. every Monday. New in rotation compilation, about 30 tracks. We fuck with hip hop, fuck with acoustic, fuck with all that shit. All the genres blended together every single week. Josh, one more time. Just, what's the worst day of the week?
Not Monday.
Because
Constant Rotation is bringing you all those compilations every Monday.
Damn, Josh. I like that. Boom.
There's only one hope. It sounds like Constant Rotation. In theaters.
Viewer discretion is advised. Bye.
This week on After the Previews, we're going to talk to you about all the news that's been going on, the big stuff, you know, the stuff you care about.
We got the hot sheets.
Green Lantern is in the Justice League. That's just announced as of like a few hours ago, as of, you know, us recording this. It'll be a couple days ago as of you hearing this. But then we're going to go into the Cars 3 teaser. Real dark. That's cool. We'll talk about that a bit more.
Stay tuned, motherfuckers.
Hey, guys. Interrupting your podcast here to bring you a fucking ad in your face, in your ears, from the wonderful place of blueberry.com, blueberry.com. That is where you'll get all your podcast hosting, podcast statistics, or if you just need a PowerPress plugin, or you could just go through full PowerPress sites, get it all in one location, one solution, seamless integration with WordPress. Exceeding your monthly storage is not a problem with blueberry.com. You will just get your overage included in the one price that you pay every single month. Replace your archive for free. Print your export. Print everything. Just get it everywhere. Pass it out to your homies. Pass it out to your grandma. Pass it out to your mom. Pass it out to your dog. Just get everything out there. But Blueberry will let you do that just for one price. Go over there. Hit order now on the homepage. Go over to the promo code. Type in variable. VARIABLE. That is variable, our promo code. It'll get you one free month of premium subscriptions from blueberry.com. Shout out to them. Thank you for sponsoring this podcast. Boom. Do a poll of like what's the worst day of the week, Josh? What would you say?
Monday.
But like can I get a little bit of a like a fuck Monday? Can we all do it together? 1, 2, 3, fuck Monday.
Well, I think Monday would lose in the pool, but personally I like it.
Josh, What I'm here to tell you is that Mondays are music oriented. Music Mondays.
That's why I like them.
Ah, dude, there we go. Where do you go? You go to soundcloud.com/concertrotation and get into that.
Where else would you go?
I don't know, but that is the place where you should be. 8 a.m. every Monday, new in rotation compilation, about 30 tracks. We fuck with hip hop, fuck with acoustic, fuck with all that shit. All the genres blended together every single week. Josh, one more time. Just, what's the worst day of the week?
Not Monday.
Because
Concert Rotation is bringing you all those compilations every Monday.
Damn, Josh, I like that. Boom.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to After the Previews. I'm your host, Kyle, and back with my trusty co-host, Garrett.
Garrett's back, feeling great, feeling rejuvenated, feeling ready to go, feeling rearing, and just overall great, dude. A new Pokemon game is in the wild. I'm feeling real happy on my And Games. You know, if you haven't heard of that, that is a podcast on the Concert Rotation Network every Wednesday about video games. But we're here to talk about movies, Kyle. Thank you for letting me join you.
I mean, it's kind of your place to be here with me, so.
This is your show, man. I'm just a guest in the show. That's what I mean, you know.
I mean,
Within the confines of this,
you're a
guest
in the sense that you're like a house guest who doesn't leave, like in the sense that you're on this show with me every week, so.
Yeah, until you kick my ass off, man.
I feel like you're like a bona fide co-host of the show and like, everything, like more than a guest.
You're the real MVP, dog.
How's your week been, man? What'd you do this week?
Honestly, play Pokemon, not see Fantastic Beasts yet, so that was my unfortunate doings.
Oh, bummer.
Yeah, I know.
You're missing out, dude. That one's, fuck, I really like it, so.
I'm going to have to go, me and my sister have been trying to go, or my sister and I have been trying to go for about 3 days now, so it'll happen. It's just, we get, with certain like franchises and movies, I always go and see them with my dad. And in this case, my sister is a part of our little small circle of movie-going extravaganzas for
the
families.
Right.
And I think we kind of just have this weird guilt of going without him, and he couldn't go on Friday when we were supposed to go, or Saturday. So, yeah, we're just kind of waiting for that. I think that's the way that we're going to go about it. So I apologize to the After the Previews fan base. Wednesday, if I don't see it by then, Kyle will shoot the review,
yeah.
And I'll just, you know, cry because I wasn't a part of it. But
I mean,
Wingardium Leviosa!
That actually is like not even a thing.
All right. Well, the Gagam Dugaba. No? Just killed your ass.
I don't think
Kyle.
That was ever a thing.
Kyle's dead. I am now the host. I gave him the deadly curse of coughs.
I think it's funny that you started doing that and I immediately started coughing right after.
We're playing into our parts, boys. This is fucking what, episode 13? We ain't fucking around anymore. We would have gotten canceled
this is episode
after
14.
Like, no, because
oh,
we,
it's 13 because
no,
we lost.
No, it's 13.
One.
It's 13.
All
it's
right.
13. You can't call it 14 if there was never a 14. You know what I mean?
Well,
we had
an 8.
That's not something that the audience needs to know or even pay attention to.
Well, we talked about it in the show, I think.
Yeah,
well,
yeah
we talked
that,
about it
that
in the
review,
next week.
The review. I put that sad message at the beginning. And I was like, hey, guys.
Sorry, everybody.
I fucked up again. My bad. Kyle, edit your own podcast. No, I'm just kidding. You want to get into these box office?
Yeah, let's jump into the box office breakdown if we're going to. We keep not calling it that. Or we keep calling
taken.
It, but like not calling it that. Whatever.
Yeah. I think it should just be, I don't know, Garrett's box office extravaganza.
We should start calling it something other than the box office.
It's the box office.
I mean, it is the box office, but like we just make up our own name for it. We could probably come up with something cool for it.
Oh, like the numbers.
Yeah, like the... maybe not the numbers, but... something
the most generic fucking... Let's get into the numbers this week. Like, God damn it. If we turn that into a proper noun, it'd just kill me. Kill me. Anyways, this is for the week of, or the weekend more so, of November 18th through November 20th. This is the weekend that just passed, pretty much. You're hearing this on Friday, and this is last Friday's shits.
Yeah.
Coming in at number one, we had Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them.
No
the
surprise.
The continuation of the Harry Potter franchise. Not a direct continuation, meaning that this is Harry's next adventure with Ron and Hermione. But this is a 1920s-based, American-centered wizarding world of Harry Potter, but based around other people, correct?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Coming in with $74.4 million this weekend.
A lot lower than they were hoping for.
Oh, 100%. They're not happy with this. This is, what, a third of what the last Harry Potter, the most recent Harry Potter mm-hmm. made? Like, because that's still in the top five best box office openings ever and top grossing movies ever.
Yeah.
Deathly Hallows Part 1 and 2. There's no debating the success of the Harry Potter franchise. And I just feel like, we got eased into the whole dark tone of like the end of Harry Potter 4 into Harry Potter 5, 6, and 7.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And I feel like they eased into it, and we were lucky enough to have like the lighter tone of 1 to like the darker side of 2, but like still not being a dark movie. It's not adult by any means in that second one.
Yeah.
And the third one, it's almost like it's
teenager.
That's a good way to put it. I was gonna say it's a kid dressing up as a fucking adult.
Like, yeah, they made those movies for us. Like mm-hmm. they came out when I was 6 with the first one.
Yeah.
And it just felt like the tone matched my age as I was growing up, you know. So when
But everything looking at this movie, Fantastic Beasts, I don't get that welcoming tone of like the magical, everything's like gray and dour and like,
well, I think they didn't make it for kids again. I think, well, actually, I saw the movie, yeah, and they didn't make it for kids.
I'm talking out of the trailers and I don't want like spoilers or anything, but like I feel like there's maybe a marketing misstep. If it is for not kids, then they need to not act like it's for kids. Does that make sense? Like, because there is a in those trailers, they are portraying towards kids.
In its name in itself too, Fantastic Beast, that is, it sounds like a kid name. But in their defense, that's the name of the textbook that this whole setting is based around. So that's,
and I mean, this is the first of 5 movies,
right,
of this new quintrilogy. Yeah, it's a fucking franchise then, but I don't want to use that word for some reason. But WB has already announced that there's gonna be 5 movies. I can't imagine that they're all gonna be Fantastic Beasts colon.
No, absolutely,
especially because from what I'm understanding, that even at the end of this movie, like, it's kind of unclear if Newt's gonna be the guy to carry this franchise.
I don't want to ruin the movie for you by telling you things like that.
No, yeah. I've heard stuff, just various anecdotal, non-spoiler discussions on various podcasts this past weekend. And I had picked up just little things. People were saying that, you know, the idea of Newt Scamander being the new Harry Potter, for lack of a better term, is not something that maybe comes forth. And I don't even like that facial expression. Coming in at number 2, though.
I don't even know the
reason where I was going with that is that maybe those are the things that I think it's more of a reflection of the marketing, not the quality of a film, is
right.
Why
right. Less no, than what yeah, no, expecting. No. Like, after watching the movie, this is definitely not the movie that the marketing team made it look like.
100%.
And I don't mean that in a bad way at all. I actually mean that in a good way, because this movie was better, in my opinion, than what I was expecting. Mm. So, and that's just my opinion. I don't want to oversell the movie for you, but I'm just saying, like, it wasn't what
no,
I was
you're the,
expecting.
You're the highest, like, on it that I've heard anyone be. So, it's a good contradiction to what I've actually been hearing. So that's cool. Coming in at number 2 is Doctor Strange, making $17.7 million, dropping 58.7%. That's
on
a more...
Week.
Yeah, on its third week, but that's the usual superhero drop that we're talking about.
Yeah.
Doctor Strange only dropped like 40% last week, if I recall correctly, or somewhere in the 40%, and that's fucking mind-blowingly low for a superhero movie, because most of the people go and see those movies first weekend, and then you're getting the repeat viewings like second weekend, and then like the person who was not necessarily into the universe, but their friend told him Doctor Strange was
cool.
Do
you remember what was its number one?
Total?
No, its opening weekend gross.
I think it was like around 70 or 80.
Yeah, because I was thinking it was something like 70 or 80, and if it was that low, I'm thinking just probably people didn't see it for opening weekend. They went back, or they heard it was good. They saw it the second weekend.
Is that low, though, for a character that's...
I mean, we're talking about a Marvel movie. The franchise is established, and it's already... You know, Marvel is that thing that people go to in the theaters. It's more than just a movie at this point. It's Shit, I mean, it's a lifestyle for some people.
It opened at 85.
Yeah, 85 million. That's kind of a low opening weekend for a superhero movie at this stage in the Marvel franchise. So that 42, I'm thinking, is a lot of people that just were like, I don't know if I want to see it. But then they heard like, oh, shit, it was actually good. Because a lot of people reviewed that movie better than we did.
Yeah.
So that's all those people thinking like, wow, that was really good. If it was really that good, then I got to go see it. I thought it was going to suck, but, you know. Because, you know, Doctor Strange isn't your Iron Man. He's not your Captain America.
That's my point, is I think 85 is actually impressive. That I think they did everything right as far as, like, a conglomeration of the right star power to get the average going audience of, like, get the Benedict Cumberbatch fans. You know what I mean?
No, I think you're right. Like, and if it was any other movie outside of this franchise, I would agree with you. But it's just because it's this. I mean, what was Ant-Man's opening weekend?
60-something. 70-something.
Right.
Low 70s.
Right. And that was like the summer blockbuster.
It was late summer, but yeah.
So.
I mean, I get what you're saying. I just think these are like, that's just, to look at it this way and say that Doctor Strange opened in November and not in the summer and did more money than Ant-Man, that they're not looking at that number saying that this is a bad number for the franchise.
Oh, no. I don't think it was a bad number.
I get what you're saying, though, because it's not doing the 100-plus like Civil War just did earlier this year. And, you know, looking forward, we have Guardians coming out.
Spider-Man
going to make a lot of money. And I think we're going to see Thor open around 85. And I think that's weird, but I think that's the number for the characters that... There's no Spider-Man in this film to get you to go to the film. Does that make sense?
Right,
and Thor isn't the biggest blockbuster, like,
and even adding
juggernaut
the Hulk to it isn't...
That's yeah, like, depending on how that trailer looks, man, and depending on how
that's
much
true.
Of the
I mean,
shots...
They could
do some sick-ass Planet Hulk. Like, we've been hearing some rumbles, you know? Yeah. We talk about this shit every week
Not
on the
only
show.
That, how long has it been since we've even seen Hulk in a movie? Like, since Age of Ultron?
Yeah, since 2015.
And even that, like...
One whole year ago.
I guess so. That's true.
No, we just talk about this shit every week, so it's
but
like,
it's like
it feels way longer.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. But not even then, like
we're just spoiled.
Hulk in Age of Ultron wasn't really like they did focus a good amount on Hulk, like and how he's a danger to society and shit like that. But I feel like it wasn't really focusing on Hulk the way that they are talking about this new Thor Ragnarok going to be focusing on Hulk.
Well, I think Thor Ragnarok in a lot of ways is a stylized I think they're doing a lot of changes in the Thor franchise, especially by bringing in Taika Waititi or whatever his name is, and he's bringing on that like 80s just look at the Thor Ragnarok logo and see all those colors. Yeah. It looks like a weird 80s like beat 'em up video.
You want to bring it up?
Yeah, I could do that. I mean, it doesn't help our listeners, but
yeah, that's true.
Coming in at number three is Trolls, making $17.4 million. So only 0.3 away from Doctor Strange's third week feat, and they open side by side. They're just, you know, going neck and neck pretty much.
Pretty much.
More or less.
Doctor Strange has got a cool $70 million on them in the overall.
Yeah.
But.
But the week percentage as far as Trolls is going to pass Doctor Strange this weekend. There's no doubt about that, in my opinion. I think it's on the upswing. Doctor Strange dropped way more.
You don't think they drop evenly?
No, I don't. Yeah. I think the fact that Trolls made so much less money that first weekend in comparison to Doctor Strange, but their third weekend, they're still like Trolls is on it.
They're
on
in more theaters, too.
Yeah, Trolls is in more theaters from the start. We've been talking about that, and I always thought it was weird. But the way I look at Trolls is that Trolls is on the upswing at this point. It's not going to make more than $17 million next week, but I think that it'll be like fucking five, and it'll be at 10 mil, and then Doctor Strange will be at nine or something. You know what I mean? Mil. And like I think it'll be like that, like the 1 million difference, but you will see Trolls, my prediction, go ahead of Doctor Strange next week. Actually thought it would happen last weekend. You know, I predicted that in our box office predictions. Coming in at number four, thank fucking God, Arrival, $12.1 million.
They went out and watched Arrival.
Yeah, I went against my own thoughts, and you know, whatever. I mean, they're almost making their budget back just in the United States with a total gross of 43.7. That's fantastic. I don't think anyone's upset with that over at Paramount. Almost Christmas, which is kind of the sleeper hit of the holiday season, along with it's like the Madea. Of the Christmas season at this point. It's making way more money than it probably should. Almost Christmas, 7.2.
I still have good ideas about that movie. Like, I wouldn't say it's like the Madea of Christmas movies.
Oh, I meant the money-wise.
Oh, gotcha.
I meant money-wise, not quality of film. I can't comment on either. Actually, because I haven't seen either, but I could probably tell you don't go see Boo.
But maybe go see Almost Christmas. You know, it's been...
I want to see Almost Christmas.
It dropped down from number 2 to number 5. Oh, no. Dropped from number 4 to number 5 on its second week. See, those little week brackets. This is coming by way of Box Office Mojo. I don't make these spreadsheets, but shout out to them. Sorry for misreading your shit. To round out the top 10.
Universal's stoked on this movie.
100%, dude. There's no way that they're not. There's no fucking movie. The next closest Universal movie in the top whatever is 17, and it's The Girl on the Train. And coming off of a record-breaking year that is last year, Universal ain't having nothing to do with anything this year as far as, like, box office totals. And Disney just smashed a record like a quarter of the way through, and they have 3 more movies coming out. Like, they had Doctor Strange, and then they have Moana, and now they have Rogue One. And
did you hear about Moana having to change their name in Italy?
No.
Yeah, they have to change their name in Italy because Moana Poxy is the name of a very famous Italian porn star. And
Jesus.
They didn't want to confuse anyone with that.
And they just wanted to separate
themselves.
What's
even more ironic is that in the past, in another Italian movie, there's some animated movie where that porn star actually voiced one of the characters. So it was even more confusing. Like, they were like, we definitely don't want anyone to think that this porn star is in our movie.
That's great.
So they changed the title to Oceana over there.
Oceana. Anyways, that's I think that's a noble title, I would say.
Yeah.
6 through 10, Hacksaw Ridge making 6.6, Edge of 17, which is a new release this week, 4.7 at number 7. Number 8, Bleed for This, the Miles Teller joint, 2.3. Number 9 is The Accountant, holding the fuck in there with another $2 million.
Another $2 million this weekend?
Yeah.
Like, who is still seeing this movie?
It's doubled its budget just in the United States, making $81.2 million on a $44 million budget. Number 10 to round out the top 10 is Shut In, and I've heard nothing but cool things about Shut In. What is the Shut In director coming in? He just took over something, and it's kind of a cool idea.
I couldn't tell you.
I'll have to look it up while we transition into our next stories. The only other new releases really is Nocturnal Animals, that Tom Ford joint, making $492,000 on 37 screens.
People, go see that movie.
I honestly been hearing not like things. I love Jake Gyllenhaal. I see every Jake Gyllenhaal movie, so I will be there. But
damn, that movie was stacked too. I mean, everyone's in it.
Yeah, I mean, Tom Ford is like literally the guy. He makes one movie every 5 years, and you just get excited. Like,
I feel like honestly, I'm thinking a lot of times. Like, I don't agree with a lot of mainstream reviews of movies, and I don't agree with a lot of critical reviews of movies these days. And I think it's because these kinds of movies, they're not. You know, they probably move slow. You know, I'm not wrong. I think this was an indie movie.
I mean,
or no, it was Shut In the indie movie. Doesn't matter.
No, these, I mean, yeah,
these thrillers,
Nocturnal Animals would be considered an indie movie for sure.
Yeah, in these kinds of movies, they move a lot slower than your typical.
You're also talking about people who have seen more movies than both of us combined, like in a year. Like, they see every movie. These are like literally you can't use a pacing thing like for literally like professional critics.
No. I'm not talking about the critical. Oh. I'm talking about the general population.
Oh, I thought you started that off saying that you don't agree with most critics. So
I don't agree with. I think they understand slow movies. Yeah. I don't agree with
everyone has their opinion.
Yeah. I don't agree with them most of the time, just because it's like,
but yeah, the general audience going to go see this movie and then they'll walk out and be like, it was slow, like, no fucking shit, it's a slow build.
Yeah,
it's a
people character like piece. If when I hear things like, oh, Nocturnal Animals, it was like but like that could be just public opinion of it, and it's correct. Like the public's opinion doesn't line up with our opinion of what a good movie is most of the time, because I mean, we don't, the public doesn't want Nocturnal Animals necessarily. The public,
I was giving that piece of information not as a reflection of how I think we'll respond to the movie, but more as like, this movie's here, this is what I hear is the idea.
No, I get that. I'm not trying to like explain this to you.
I want to explain to the people too, because anyone listening to us who's maybe like, why are these guys commenting on movies that they haven't seen? The way that I differentiate that as best as I can is I say they or I've heard.
Right.
Those are like my two giveaways where it's like, Garrett probably isn't talking about him. Like, you know, and I hope that you take that with a grain of salt and maybe, you know, do your own research.
Yeah. But, I mean, I hope by this point, like, as much as we've both said, like, we don't like to shit on things that we haven't seen unless it's just utterly ridiculous.
But sometimes in the show, we have to a certain extent.
Yeah, absolutely. I just mean, like, I hope that at this point,
we would
like,
have two news items if it was actual news items, not speculative.
No, I mean, like, I think at this point, if people haven't understood that we don't like, we're not fully judging things that we haven't seen, then I mean,
then get out.
Yeah, then get out. If you think we're judging, then get out of here. Anyway, Nocturnal Animals came in at 18.
Yeah, so 21 was Manchester by the Sea on four theaters, making $25,000 or $256,000, $64,000 per theater. The only other new release at 27 is I Am Not Madame Bovary, $181,000. Manchester by the Sea is going to do way more money, though.
Yeah, dude. $64,000 per theater, because they've only been in four theaters. Right
now, from what I understand.
From what I understand, it's the movie of the year. Mm-hmm. Like, literally the best movie of the year.
That and let's make a comment real quick. We weren't able to do justice the conversation of Edge of 17.
But
go see Edge of 17, guys. It's like sitting at like 100% on Rotten Tomatoes or something.
Retarded. Yeah, this is another one. Like, critics are calling it, and after I just said I don't agree with critics.
No, but we have to talk about it. Yeah. Like, it's important for you to understand Kyle's position on critics, but you can't use that against us when we quote the critics, because that's our fucking job here, guys. Like, in the end, we can't see every movie as much as we can, unless you want to pay us. It's at a 95% on Rotten Tomatoes. I will sit in a movie
after the weekend is over. Yes. Like, this is
everything.
That's the drop. It dropped to 95. This is clearly one of the best movies ever made.
And the Kelly Freeman, Freeman Craig, dude, that's the biggest rave right now, is her directing and like her ability to tell a story.
This is her third movie. No, this is her directorial debut.
Yeah, that was the big thing, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
This is, I'm going to have to probably see this
week. She hasn't even been involved in movies in 7 years.
You know how weird that's
7 years, dog. Look at the separation in her filmography.
She wrote her last movie in 2009.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, I'm sure she's been around doing shit, but...
Yeah, maybe like... No, I mean, she doesn't have any producer credits, so...
No, dog. I mean, I'm saying that she's obviously a force in the industry at Variety, saying that she's the 10 screenwriters to watch.
Yeah, absolutely.
And maybe she's just been riding Edge of 17.
It's
going
to look so weird when I go to the theater by myself. Like, can I get a ticket to Edge of 17?
Hey, man, it's a good movie.
It's a coming-of-age story about a teenage girl.
Yeah.
Who's the actress
in this movie? Was she in Unknown?
Her name is Hailee Steinfeld. Oh, she was in Pitch Perfect 2.
Yeah, all right, yeah. All right.
She's in
a lot of shit. She was nominated for a fucking Oscar, wasn't she, at like 14?
What the fuck was the other movie I saw her in? I liked her in this other movie so much more than I liked her in Pitch Perfect 2.
Is this the girl? She was for True Grit. That's what it was.
That's the
youngest
one, True Grit. I loved her in True Grit.
I was tripping. I was like, dude, this chick is like literally the girl who like was on everybody's list of just like...
She needs better roles.
Yeah. I think her agent kind of fucks her a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, Pitch Perfect 2 did well. And if you go by like public opinion, then yeah.
But you know that Ender's Game was meant to be like a
Ender's Game was supposed to be bigger, and it didn't do what it was supposed to.
She was Juliet in Romeo and Juliet. But
this
I don't
like
even remember.
Some new... it's like a modern adaptation of it, I think.
Yeah, it's British from 20.
No, sorry. No. This isn't modern. That's just... It's just not... from here.
Gotcha. Yeah, so that's pretty much all the noteworthy things. Go see Edge of 17. Go see Bleed for this. Go see Nocturnal Animals and Manchester by the Sea, I would say.
Go see Shut In. Hey, go see A Street Cat Named Bob if you can. Any of our listeners out in the British, what a dumbass. If we have any listeners in the UK, here, A Street Cat Named Bob is actually really good. So.
Nice. I've never even heard of that.
I watched the trailer. It looks... The trailer doesn't actually look like it's going to be that good of a movie, but from what I'm hearing from early reviews, it was a really good movie.
Hell yeah.
The trailer looked corny, but whatever.
All right. Well, I'll shut the fuck up now and let Kyle take over. That is our top 10.
All right, so let's get into the headlines. We got Andrew Stanton, big superstar over at Pixar Films. He recently spoke with... the fuck did he talk to?
Movies.com.
He talked to them about they asked about a possible crossover film maybe in the future of Pixar, or like a Pixar extended universe. Like, why haven't you done this yet? And I fucking love his response. And his response was basically, we would do that if there was like ever a good reason to do it, but just the fact that people want to see that, or that that's like the cool thing to do right now, is not what we're gonna do. And I fucking love that, because that's like, Pixar is one of the biggest names in movie industry right now. Like, everyone knows who Pixar is. Everyone knows what they do if you've seen a movie. And for for the superstar at Pixar to have artistic integrity, that just that says so much good things to me, because like I like, you know, people always say, oh, why didn't that guy make it? Oh, because he has artistic integrity. Anyone with artistic integrity would fail. Clearly not the case. And mm-hmm. I love that, because like I don't want to see a crossover or an extended universe or a, you know, connected universe of Pixar films if that's the only reason they do it.
I don't want to see a connected universe of the previous Pixar films, but I think they could say like, hey, we're starting a cinematic universe now, and every movie afterwards is going to be a part of this new thing that we're doing.
Yeah, absolutely.
And like, you know, I can't judge that, because everything that they do is pretty much gold. And like, I feel like if they really wanted to make a universe of like these characters, that not the characters that they've already made, but something new. Yeah, I can't even. It's hard.
Yeah,
for me
no,
to
no.
Talk
that's,
about it.
That's basically what he's saying. It's
that'd
like,
be cool.
Yeah, that's pretty much what it is. Is like, yeah, we'll keep dropping these Easter eggs in between movies and shit like that. Where yep. it's like, yeah, they're technically connected, but as far as like the, you know, crossover or extended, it's exactly what you said. Like, if it comes up in the future and they have a good reason to do it, then they'll do it.
Yeah.
And if they ever do it, after hearing this from Andrew Stanton, I would say I wouldn't have any doubts that it would be a great film franchise.
Of course. I mean, if they're all on the same page, you know what I mean? Like, Marvel works so well. The Marvel Cinematic Universe, that is, works so well in comparison to that Fox X-Men universe.
Yeah.
Because there's a... They already have the movie in 2020 planned out, storyboarded, ready to go, and that's just, you know, that and it's
that
set.
And like all the directors are close-knit, or not close-knit, but they, you know, they work closely together. Like, okay,
I
what
think they just match the tone, you know?
Yeah.
Or they
and
fit
not
their
only that,
directing
but it's also
style
like, hey,
into
what are you throwing into your movie? Or like, what are you doing? Even like down to the Stan Lee cameos. It's like,
yeah.
Oh, what are you going to do for the Stan Lee cameo in yours? Probably this, blah, 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 blah. Because, right, you know, they already have all of them filmed already.
I mean, yeah, they filmed like four or whatever.
Was it four?
Yeah, not no. all. They always had him come in for a day to shoot. For all the every cameo that we've ever seen was not shot in concession. That just recently, because he's 92 years old, they
yeah.
started banking him. And like James right, Gunn right. brought him in for the Guardians of the two Guardians of the Galaxy 2 cameo, and whether it was Stan Lee's camp being like, "Hey, Stan doesn't want to keep coming back like every 6 months to do this like
right,
two
right.
seconds of film." So then James Gunn like literally called.
You know, that was his complaint in the Deadpool cameo, was that he just wished it was longer.
Oh, really? That was it?
Because he was the strip club manager.
Yeah.
He's like, I just wish I could have been in there longer.
Poor Stan. But yeah, I think, and James Gunn was talking about how like he was literally shooting shit for like Taika Waititi in the Thor, like his Thor cameo. And he's like literally sending him like framing shots, being like, James Gunn was basically pretending to be another director for another director's movie for the sake of not fucking up like anything. So
right.
him and Taika were like literally like Skyping each other. And he's like, is this correct? And he's like, oh.
And that's why
like,
I think
no,
the
Marvel
Universe works so well, is because like we said, like everything down to the Stan Lee cameos, like they all work together so well like that.
Yeah, it sounded like James Gunn spent like 8 hours shooting these cameos. I don't think he did. One little quote that I want to pull out is you're just making a product if you're only doing it for any reason other than character and story, and we have yet to think of an idea or character story that demands we do a crossover. Yeah, I respect that.
And then he goes on, but I'm telling you, the second something seems to support that, we would do it. That's fucking tied to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we do things because we're telling, like, there's another one, there's another quote he said earlier in the interview, and I can't remember what it was, but it was along the lines of like, it like, we're not doing this because people want it to, or we're not doing anything that we do because we think it's what people want. We're doing it because we have a story to tell, and that's what we do. Like, it wasn't in this interview. It was another interview that he did about Toy Story 4's release date being pushed back.
Uh-huh.
He said that it's not, you don't have to worry, because we don't push things back for trivial stuff like problems. We push things back because we want more time to perfect the story, and that's so cool to me. Like, okay, we don't care about what weekend we release our movie.
I think they're just scared, honestly. They just need time. Yeah, it's respectable, but that's one movie that they will not fuck up, I don't think, because
oh, absolutely, they put so much time into making that franchise as perfect as it is. I mean, you can talk about.
I just mean that like Toy Story is literally the best trilogy ever made, arguably, and it's like, bro, why are you even making a four? Like, just let it be, you know?
Well,
but like,
you know, they said that they never planned on that only being three movies.
There's plenty of quotes from that point saying that this is an end to the trilogy, to the story. Yeah, there's plenty of shit. And then they literally said the only reason that they're doing four is because John Lasseter came in to fucking with a great idea. And I think that's cool.
Hmm.
But that's, you know, that's fine. But it's just like,
That's weird. I just read something.
We don't need to do that
shit. They planned on doing four for a long time.
I mean, maybe they're saying that now because there's four.
They're like, fuck.
I'm saying, I'm telling you, in 2010 when that shit came out, they were not saying that.
Huh?
They're saying that this is an end. This is the Toy Story story.
I mean, it makes sense for them to have thought.
Think about
that
movie. Yeah. Think about that movie.
No, absolutely.
There's nothing in that movie that even insinuates a trilogy or any continuation or anything, other than the fact that they hand that doll off to the girl.
Right.
But if you're sitting there saying that I want to watch that girl own the same dolls that Andy did, then you're already doing exactly what's wrong with the movie industry and making a sequel out of shit that doesn't need a sequel.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with that wholeheartedly.
We got some Winnie the Pooh shit.
Yeah, Mark Forster.
No pun intended.
Mark Forster has been hired to direct a live action movie about Winnie the Pooh's owner, Christopher Robin.
Mark Foster, man.
Forster.
Forster. Mark Forster.
This
Mark Foster.
I can't say I'm surprised that Disney is making a live action Winnie the Pooh. It just seems extremely surreal because they're all stuffed animals.
Well, it's like they're doing like a different spin on it too. It's like Christopher Robin.
Yeah, it's about Christopher Robin, not Winnie the Pooh. Yeah. So I don't even know how much the animals are being in there.
Picture Mowgli from the Jungle Book, and that's about the role that Christopher Robin will have. Like,
yeah, pretty much. He'll be
unimportant. There's a lot more other like you didn't go to the Jungle Book to go watch Mowgli.
Right.
No one did.
You're right. That is,
I don't like Mark Forster's work necessarily. Mainly, dude.
I'm gonna say my favorite is Stranger Than Fiction.
That's all right. Mainly because the fucking Quantum of Solace is a terrible movie. Stranger Than Fiction is pretty bad too, in my opinion.
Really?
Yeah. Sorry. World War Z came together, but the idea of that movie working shouldn't have worked, and I can't honestly put that on Forrester because he's also the reason that like 80% of that movie got reshot. You know what I mean? You don't just direct a movie and then have it just be scrapped and then retooled for like because you did a good job. That doesn't happen.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it came together at the end because of him or if like the studio had to jump in and be like, yo, motherfucker. You're like,
he's got a lot of nominations for Finding Neverland.
Yeah, I mean, that shit got eaten up. Just eaten up, dog.
What did it win? Best
original score.
Yeah.
Not his doing.
I mean, fucking A, dude. Monsters Ball, whatever. I don't know. Finding Neverland was a whatever movie. Did you ever see it?
I didn't. I always told myself I would, but it's like so long ago. Fuck it.
Yeah. Whatever, man. I mean, cool. I don't know. Whatever. It's like about...
It's not even like canon to like Peter Pan, you know? It's about the guy who wrote Peter Pan.
Yeah.
So
you know some shit.
Yeah. It didn't capture my attention in the sense that like I was going to see another Peter Pan movie.
We were young, so when that shit came out too.
Yeah, that's true.
Bigger movies?
Bigger movies are going to start costing more. As far as AMC is concerned, AMC just bought I don't remember what the company's called. It's some European movie company, and the cinema out there, Odeon and UCI, they hike up the prices for summer blockbusters. So if you are a regular AMC cinema goer, expect to pay more next summer.
I mean, it's not for sure yet, right? There's no announcement from AMC themselves, right?
You know, I don't know.
It's basically just the culture of the studio industry of the movies is basically making a prediction saying that this will happen.
Yeah, yeah. But it's based on their quote here. They say they, being Odeon and UCI, the European companies, they are further advanced in variable pricing where tentpole movies are priced up on release. That's something we've talked about in the U.S. We expect to learn a lot with what they've done. We think it will position us to start having those conversations about pricing opportunities in the U.S.
Yeah.
So they're not saying, yeah, for sure, we're going to start hiking up our prices.
I mean, everyone's going to pay for it, though, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, exactly. It's not like
that's the problem, you know, that's the real problem in life.
Is that they can charge whatever they want and we're gonna go see it anyway. Like, I mean, case in point, I just drove all the way to Hollywood from Inland Empire where I am.
Yeah, you did.
To see Billy Lynn's Long Halftime Walk, and that cost like $19 on top of the fucking 60-mile drive I made. Yeah. But you know, it's people want to see movies, they're going to see movies.
Preach.
So Anyway, let's move on to the next one. Emilia Clarke, Game of Thrones star. She's just been added to the Han Solo solo film alongside Alden Ehrenreich and Donald Glover. This cast is stacked, dude. Like, they couldn't take more of my money, and they're just like, hey, we want more of your money.
Yeah, I just wish she was, like, a better actress. I don't know, like, she's cool in Game of Thrones. I just think that, like...
But that's, like, her biggest credit.
No, I'm saying that, like... What do you mean? I'm saying, like, what saying else do you want me to go off of? Fucking Terminator Jenny Smith?
No.
Yeah, like, but I mean, that shit. But no, let me finish my point. I'm saying that on Game of Thrones, she's okay. She's good. The best parts that she even, like, shows any sort of redeeming actress quality of roles, I would feel like, is when she's, like, raising hell with her dragons. But, like, even that, like, she's yelling, and it's more of, like, the dragons that give her the clout for what, like, gives credence to what she's saying. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
I think Game of Thrones is a wonderfully written show, and the storytelling is very masterful in the way that they do it through the environment and all that stuff. But I don't feel like there's anything that I've seen Emilia Clarke do that is A, well written, and B, actually shows that she can carry a role in a dramatic sense and, like, a believable sense.
I get
now,
that.
Now, put that in the Star Wars world. I don't think Star Wars is necessarily, like, the most quality filmmaking.
Like, dramatic, yeah.
But that's what I want. That's what I want out of the actors.
That's true, yeah. If but you're going to bring about it, this is a Han Solo anthology film, so you're probably going
to
have...
You're bringing an indie actor to play Han Solo. Like, you. Right. How many people did they fucking... interview? Not interview.
Audition.
Audition, there we go. How many people did they audition to get that role, and they picked this indie guy, Alden Ehrenreich?
Yeah.
I think there's got to be some acting chops that's going on. And with the reports today that this is like a Western movie from Phil Lord and Chris Miller.
Right.
It's a little bit interesting.
That's what I'm thinking here is that, like, that dark, dramatic, gritty tone that you're saying that you want. I don't think we're getting that out of the Han Solo anthology film. Mostly because, I mean, think about Han Solo as a character. He's like... You know, he's not really a dark, gritty guy. He's more of like a, hey, I fucking do what I want because I'm
Necessarily mean dark. I just meant like gravitas.
No. I want to believe her.
And I didn't believe her in Terminator. And that's the only feature film that I can base her
off of. I wouldn't say
I
believed her in Terminator. I didn't think it like she was horrible in that, but I don't know.
Apples to apples.
Yeah, like that movie... Terminator's a hard movie to, like, really criticize.
That movie's terrible. That movie's fucking awful. Sorry.
Really?
That movie is garbage. That movie is hot shit on a plate served to me.
I feel like I have to rewatch it, because when I was watching that, all I got was, like...
I mean, it was nostalgia for me because I was taste in movies sometimes too.
Yeah, absolutely. But I got to rewatch it, because, like, I know for sure when I was watching it, I was thinking, like, certain things about that movie I just couldn't... I couldn't get behind. Like turning fucking turning John Connor into the Terminator...
That's
not cool.
No. It's like whatever.
That's not Terminator.
Like, bro, if this was the first Terminator movie ever made, no one would ever talk about this again.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And that's the thing is when I was watching it, it was all nostalgia because I was like, fuck yeah, dude, this is T2.
I don't even think they did it good.
And that's what I'm
saying.
Don't
compare that to T2.
No. It's not T2. I just mean, like, I love T2 so much where I was in the theater like, fuck yeah, dude.
I was like, it just backhanded me on the show.
I get to go see T2 again because that was the movie that James Cameron was saying, like, this is the real Terminator.
How much money they paid him.
I'm hoping that's why he said that, because, like, if he's getting behind that movie as the real Terminator 3, like, fuck you, man. Terminator Salvation was more of a Terminator 3 than that movie.
True. But James Cameron just got paid out like hella hard. He got hella he basically Steven Spielberg that whole franchise.
Probably,
and just
put
his name on it, took the check.
Well, you know, he sold the rights to that franchise back in the 80s for like a dollar or something.
Because he wanted to, what was it?
He wanted more time for something else.
It was like for something like, for another movie they made. It was basically like the precursor to like Titanic or
something like that.
But yeah,
anyway.
Emilia Clarke, cool. Haven't really seen her in anything that like,
I think
blew
she was
my
good
mind.
Enough in Terminator Genisys, in my opinion. I think she was good enough that she'll play a good character in this Han Solo anthology film. It's kind of the same tone, you know?
Yeah, I get it. I just don't want to run in the mill actress like playing in this like action role. Like that's I want it true. To be more. And maybe I'm just, you know, maybe I'm overhyping the idea of this new Star Wars anthologies, but I want them to be character pieces. I don't see the point in going and focusing on Han Solo to begin with when you have such a vast galaxy. Like, honestly, if you're going to go back and pick Han Solo, not saying that Han Solo isn't the character that you would pick if you're going to pick a fucking character that already exists in the universe to make a movie on. Right. But like the fact that you're focusing on such a intricate thing of like a time frame that we've already gone past, it's almost like you're shrinking the galaxy in a way. And like, I don't know if, but if you are going to do it, at least make it like a cool character piece and like actually show that, like, I don't know, the etymology of the character.
Yeah,
and, like,
no, absolutely.
But don't do it in a way that like,
it's
like,
corny.
Like, yeah, that's corny. Yeah, like, I don't want it to be a,
feed me
I don't
some
want
bullshit.
I don't want it to be like a prequel, dude.
No, absolutely. I have like, really I hope this isn't a prequel.
Free light. It's going to be a prequel. Like, it's not going to take place like after Force Awakens.
No.
Like, spoilers, because like, he's fucking yeah, dead. Right. He's fucking dead. But you know what I mean? Like, no matter what, we're going back.
Just an hour and a half of like camera on.
And
his
you
grave.
Know, this chick doesn't exist in the canon of like the other movies. Like, we've never seen this character as far as we know.
True.
So it's like, where did she go? And then and that.
You know what else? We don't even know that she's playing a human character.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, could be playing a costume.
100%. She could be a motion cap for all we know.
Like, yeah.
She could be a Max von Sydow and be
Phil
in the first
Lord and
2 seconds.
I'm hoping Phil Lord and Chris Miller can bring out the good actress in Emilia Clarke.
Dude, like I said, I think there's a reason they cast her. I don't know, man. I feel like there's also a chance that they picked her because she's hot right now. Like,
yeah.
Hot, like she's a like,
yeah, no, absolutely.
Similar audiences between Game of Thrones and fucking
Star Wars,
same type of fantasy world building. And if you think
if,
about it,
if it goes
Game
to
of Thrones
Comic-Con,
is about to start.
To
the last season
Comic-Con.
Of Game of Thrones is about to start right when this movie comes out.
Right.
Just throwing that out there.
Yeah.
Just throwing that out there.
They could be a timing thing.
No, it's 100% a timing thing. They don't just do this shit by accident. And if she's going for the same role that Tessa Thompson was up for, I quit. That's about it. Because you don't just whitewash a character again in a Star Wars movie when you tease that she's going to be playing this character from the comics. Anyways, did you catch that too about all those casting rumors, how all those actresses were African-American and then now they cast a white woman?
Oh no, I didn't.
But we don't
that.
Know if it's
yeah.
Same
I don't
part.
Know. If I didn't focus on that because I'm hoping that she didn't replace those.
Yeah, me
actresses.
Too. I was just saying they better not be the same.
Yeah.
Character.
Anyway,
I'll laugh my ass off.
We all know Deadpool 2 has been waiting on announcing a new director since Tim Miller's departure. Well, they were talking about rumors, maybe David Leitch from John Wick. You know, the guy who did more of the action directing
maybe
in that
Drew
film.
Drew Goddard from Cabin in the Woods.
Yep. Well, they officially landed on David Leitch after focusing on him for the better part of 2 weeks now. Yep. They've officially landed on him. He's the new director. I think that's good. We're gonna see. We already know that a lot of the success in Deadpool came from Ryan Reynolds himself, you know, being such a big Deadpool fanboy.
And it was a good movie.
Yeah, I know. It was a good
movie.
And
it was counter-programming on that Valentine's Day weekend. There's a lot of variables that I don't think the studio even understood what was going on.
That's
like,
true.
There's a lot. Like, I think that was honestly a paradox of, like, certain. Like, no movie's supposed to make that much money in February.
Yeah. Not only that, no rated R movie makes that much money.
Mm-hmm. That too, man.
Unless and wasn't unless it didn't Jesus it break records for like a comic book movie too?
I mean, maybe, but nothing like total grossing or anything like that.
Yeah.
But maybe like highest grossing rated R comic book movie for sure. I mean, obviously.
Yeah.
But I don't
what know. Did it beat? Punisher.
Yeah.
Fucking
Punisher.
Watchmen.
Yeah, Watchmen. Yeah, it did. Fuck you.
Anyway. They landed on David Leitch. He's the action director from John Wick. That's cool. So we're going to see some gung-fu, a lot of it, in this movie probably. And that, I think, mixes well with Ryan Reynolds' comedy Deadpool. So, cool. That's basically the height of that story.
Yeah, it's going to be a quick one. I like the idea of this guy who has a very strong stunt background coming in and maybe... I think this guy is the right guy to bring in to not fuck with Ryan Reynolds' vision, and that's clearly
so
what's going on. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Reportedly, like, they had a meeting in New York. He met with Ryan. Literally, he was offered the role, like, 12 hours later.
Right.
Like, and then it was a done deal. So it's like, Ryan just wants someone who he can tell what to do. And,
pretty
like,
much, I think.
That's fine, but I also want David to also contribute to where he knows what the fuck's up, and maybe if the stunts are something that he can help out with. I don't know. You know what I mean? It's like... This movie is basically being directed vicariously through Ryan Reynolds.
Right.
And like, that bothers me. I hate that shit. I fucking hate the diva actors. It's like, either the studio needs to trust in him to actually direct the movie because he wants to direct the movie. You think if they're like, hey, man, you want to direct Deadpool? He'd be like, fuck yeah, but they just don't want him to. For whatever reason, they don't want him to have his debut directing, like, through this big budget movie. And I understand that it goes against it, but it's like, if you're already going to let him call the shots anyways. He doesn't want to have his
directorial debut credit on a sequel, you know?
That's fucking dumb if that's how it is, because you're the star of that movie. You know what I mean? Like, you're the star of that movie. Like, what better movie to have your directorial, other than Deadpool, would be Deadpool 2, right, which won't be called Deadpool 2, I don't think. It would be called, like,
Deadpool and Cable, I think.
Deadpools.
Aren't they calling it Deadpool and Cable?
Deadpools.
Or Cable and Deadpool?
No, Deadpools. You heard it here first. But they also are putting into motion Deadpool 3. That's another piece of information.
They were already working on that like a couple weeks ago. They were talking about writing.
Writing. Like actual writers are being hired. Like it was like storyboarding being like contributed. Like the story ideas of like what the, like basically what we heard last week with this whole Tim Miller leaving was that Deadpool 3 was going to feature New Mutants.
That
like it was going to be a spinoff into that idea of X-Force and shit. But now it's saying that like it's actually being written and that they're like trying to push that. Like it's going to be Deadpool 2 in like 2 years or a year and a half from now, and then like a year from that is Deadpool 3 going into X-Force.
Gotcha.
So, I don't
know. That's cool with me. If they can do it right, if they write, you know, if they do the comics justice, fine. Because I loved Deadpool and Cable, and I loved when they brought in Cable to the, or you know, X-Force, and
that's for
every time
what I understand.
Deadpool crosses over.
I could be
No. I mean, it's so fucking far off. They could change that at any point.
Everything we talk about is speculative. Yeah, so there's about 30 different spins on the story.
Yeah, exactly. Mortal Kombat, they're rebooting again. I'm surprised they would even do that after that last reboot. What was it, Mortal Kombat Annihilation or something?
Yeah,
Jesus.
First Mortal Kombat movie, still the best video game movie ever made.
Hell yeah. I'm about to go rewatch that this weekend probably.
Hell yeah.
Simon McCoy, he's best known for actually commercials. He directs those PlayStation Epic commercials. They're actually pretty good.
Yeah, fuck with those commercials a lot, actually.
He's just been hired to direct the Mortal Kombat reboot, so maybe, you know, he's got experience in the video game world. As far as directing something cinematic, maybe he brings something good to Mortal Kombat reboot.
Maybe.
Hopefully. I mean, that's all we can do is hope for a good movie.
Fuck.
So, yeah. Simon McCoy.
I don't know. I mean, there's not much to talk about this guy as far as like what he's done. I think I think with this franchise being helmed by James Wan, which like producer-wise it is, I think we'll be in good hands because whatever that guy touches tends to work out, you know?
And he's good with that. I mean, he's good with like the thriller, almost horror type movies. And I guess you could say that Mortal Kombat is kind of like that in that sense that it's just really dark and like, fuck. I mean, the violence is kind of scary.
Yeah. Oh, so he made that the most recent PlayStation commercial.
Yeah.
With Kratos and shit. Oh, that's tight.
Hey, he made the Netflix commercial. Dude, he's made a
bunch. He made that Duracell for Rogue One.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I thought you meant he made the old school PlayStation commercials, because there's like PS3 era had the best PlayStation
commercials. Those are pretty cool commercials. When that kid goes up to the door and it's all the games inside of there and they're
gonna
like,
have a good day. Like that song fucking was popping on the commercial. I don't know. Anyways, I don't know, you know, I just, these video game movies, man.
You can skip that one, we already talked about it.
All right, let's talk about some
Angela Bassett. She's been hired.
Reel it in, Kyle.
Angela Bassett has been hired to play in Black Panther. She's going to be T'Challa's mother in the movie. That's
spoilers.
I see nothing but good things here. Angela Bassett is one of the great actresses of, I guess, the generation between us and our parents.
Yeah,
I would agree.
She's great. Honestly, I don't have anything bad to say about that. I don't really have anything other than it's great to say about that either.
I have nothing bad to say about this cast. I think the idea of this being literally the most for lack of a better way to say it, like the most black cast that we have in Hollywood. Like, that is brilliant, man. Like, you have, I know, Black Panther, Black Cat, like, duh. But it's like, dude, you didn't have to, like, sorry, I'm not trying to be offensive and, like, ignorant by saying
no,
this.
No,
but it's like,
no,
I think this is something that has to be said, is that this is something that you...
This
you,
is a movie that needed to be made a long time ago.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's finally being made is great. And the fact that they keep adding more black actors and actresses, African-American, if that offends you, I'm sorry.
Nah. I think we're over that.
But, yeah, the fact that they keep adding more actresses...
Over the idea of calling someone black is offensive. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. No.
Got it. Political correctness on a podcast is just real
so
challenging
hard.
Sometimes.
So hard.
Yeah. I love my audience. And I love you. No matter what.
The audience, right?
Yeah, you too, Kyle. You're all right. You're permissible.
You're good.
You're passable.
Good. Right on.
You're serviceable.
I love it here.
I love it here.
Anyway, no, I do think this is a movie that needed to be made a long time ago, and it didn't, and now it's finally being made, and I think that's amazing. This is a huge step forward.
That's the point. I think anyone could have made this movie years ago, but the fact that it's being made now, and that we're in the point of time with this Oscar so white thing that, you know, they're actually casting the right people. They're not fucking around here. They're not, you know, throwing in Cameron Diaz because she'll bring in some money. It's like Angela Bassett will sell tickets in her
own. Now, people would argue that they just did the opposite with Doctor Strange casting Tilda Swinton as the Ancient One instead of Ed.
I think this also has a lot to do with Ryan Coogler, though. Think about his past two films, Fruitvale Station,
and
Creed.
Yeah.
Those are, you know, they have something to say about the racial wars in this American culture right now.
Yeah, and that's, I think Ryan Coogler is a great director in that sense that he's really good at telling that story.
Yeah.
And not telling that story, but, like, you know, making those kinds of points, you know. Being,
I agreed with you, but I knew what you meant.
Yeah.
Sorry.
But, like, I fucking hate saying, like, being a voice for the African American culture.
But someone needs to be
Someone needs to be thought of as a voice. Nobody is the voice of the black culture or the African-American culture.
No,
nobody.
It's not even that. It's just, I think there's a crowd of people out there who are looking for a vehicle to transport the idea or the message that they're trying to say. And there is no vehicle, like, right now in film on the mainstream level.
Right.
And
this
is a big budget movie.
I think the closest thing to it is Luke Cage.
Yeah.
And what? Another fucking Marvel property? How great is that for Marvel?
Yeah, man. I think Luke Cage, you hit it right on the nose, man. This is literally, like, I don't think they can go as topical as Luke Cage, and I don't think they can be as interpersonal due to the fact that there's a runtime on this
movie. Yeah, exactly. They don't have 13 episodes.
So they will have to hit the same beats to a certain extent that Doctor Strange did. Like, I feel like we may have
But we already know it's not an origin story, so
yeah.
The story doesn't have to hit the same beats that way.
We know Winter Soldier is in Wakanda right now, too.
What?
Winter Soldier's in Wakanda right now, too, so that might...
Is he?
At the end of Civil War...
Wasn't
they
he put back on ice?
And then he's in Wakanda.
But he's, like, in storage in Wakanda.
He's in Wakanda. He was just in T'Challa's little domain, dude. They zoom out, and it's just a little, like...
You but he's, like, frozen.
But you can just unfreeze him. What do you mean?
I
guarantee Bucky's going to be unfrozen in this movie. Like,
okay.
What do you mean? Why would they freeze him
and tease that he's
in Wakanda if they're not going to bring him back when they go to Wakanda?
Fuck, I don't know.
Why would that rule of thumb not apply to Bucky when it applies to everyone else in this universe?
I don't know. When they lay
the groundwork for something and then it plays out in another movie.
I don't know.
It's like them name-dropping Hulk. Like, oh, Hulk's gone. I wonder when he's coming back. Like, they're like, you know he's coming back. It's not like they're just going to keep name-dropping him.
No, of course. I don't know. In my head, ideally, it's like Winter Soldier doesn't come back so quickly.
Oh, but this is a 2018 movie.
This is 2016
that he went under.
So I don't know why I'm thinking this is a 2017
Sebastian
movie.
Stan still has like four more movies to flex out on his contract.
Yeah,
so
that's true.
Had like a 12-picture deal. He had like one of the longer ones out of all of them, which is weird, but whatever.
Yeah, right? Bucky in all those movies?
That's why people thought he was going to take over as Captain America.
I was thinking that would probably explain like if he was to take over as Captain America.
That was like the biggest headline back in like 2012 or whatever.
See, I didn't keep up with headlines back then.
Yeah, well, look where we are now, Kyle. Would have fucking paid off.
Made it our job to be headlines.
Would have paid it off, Kyle.
Anyway, Tomb Raider's coming out with a movie.
Looking for a nuke. No. That's me and Alex's joke. Sorry. And games every Wednesday.
Anyway, yeah, Tomb Raider is actually not going to be what we thought it was going to be.
Okay.
In the sense that, you know, they talked about how it's going to be tied in with the Tomb Raider video games that are coming out right now.
Mm-hmm.
But now they're saying that it's going to be a back to the roots story. Young Lara Croft in search of her father, trying to find out if he's dead or alive. So, I don't know how that ties in with the games, because Brandon didn't let me borrow his Rise of the Tomb Raider yet, so I don't know how the second game plays out. But that back to the roots story doesn't at all fit in with the first Tomb Raider in the modern franchise. So
you're talking about the reboot?
Yes.
You played that?
Yeah.
Oh, sweet.
I fucking loved it. I think I played it 3 times actually.
Yeah, it doesn't have, yeah.
The replay value wasn't that good. It's like the first time I replayed it because I was like, okay, I want to see what I missed. And the second time I replayed it because it was like a year or two later and I was like, I haven't played this game in 5
years. Now, does this mean that this is in the continuity of the game?
See, that's the thing, is I don't know. Like, they said it was supposed to tie in with the games.
Like, the same character? Like, that is the same Lara Croft?
Right.
So then, why would we want it to retread the story? Because then, that story would have already happened. I'm saying, are we going into this movie saying that, like, for those who played the game, just know she already did those things?
No. Okay. And that's not what I would want to see anyway.
No, I was saying then that kind of constricts the story, but that would also explain why it's not having to do with the first game, because if those events already happened, or if it's like saying that these events are going to happen on a timeline, then you don't want to retread them in a movie.
See, I don't know. Now, what they're saying here is they say we call it a back to the roots story. Now, maybe it does fit in with the story of what's going on in the game, not in the sense that they're, you know, showing you.
I think that's just a safe word, too, in Hollywood because of Star Wars and shit. Like,
yeah.
Back to the roots.
That's a good point.
Just like Force Awakens.
I didn't think about that. And I was actually like, that kind of ties in with the point I was just about to make, is that maybe they're not actually going back to the roots in the sense of like showing you a story of her before the events of Tomb Raider 1. Maybe this is like after Rise of the Tomb Raider video game. And
possibly, man, but I don't like that either.
Because she's still young in those games, you know? So it could be young Lara Croft after Rise of the Tomb Raider.
But if you're going to say that this is like an origin in a way for the character,
I don't think this is an origin.
Then that's weird, dude. This is all weird. Why?
Because it's a movie, right?
Well, no, I just mean that, like, how are you going to introduce this to the masses?
That's what I mean.
Without, like, doing an origin.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, because it's a movie, and, like, most of these people probably haven't played the games. How can they continue a story from the games in a movie that all these people haven't,
I think
they don't know about?
The secret is it doesn't work.
Yeah, I think it doesn't work.
Shit.
I don't know. Well, I guess we'll have to see when more details come out about this. This was one of those clickbaity titles, I guess, what the movie's actually going to be about, and they're like giving you some bullshit like, oh, back to the roots.
100%. I just caught on to that as well. That kind of rubbed me the wrong way. Amber Heard?
Amber Heard. She's being sued for undermining a movie that she was recently a part of. London Fields. Yeah, London Fields. I don't know exactly what they mean by undermining the movie. I guess just saying bad things about it. Let's see what it says.
Says
here.
The actress allegedly refused to shoot the film according to the script provided to her, and subsequently refused to attend the Toronto International Film Festival in order to promote the film.
Okay, so she was in breach of contract. Probably not the best thing going on for her right now, being with the marital problems between her and Johnny Depp.
Yeah.
She's just not having a good year.
Yeah.
So
I mean, fuck. I mean, we'll see how Justice League plays out. And speaking of Justice League, titular news.
Green Lantern was just announced earlier today that Green Lantern is definitely going to be a part of Justice League.
I think, it's kind of vague.
You think Hal Jordan or Jesus Christ, other name?
John Stewart.
John Stewart, thank you.
I would actually challenge the idea that... all right, let's look at it this way. This is how I would challenge it. I say you show us Guy Gardner.
Guy Gardner?
The guy with the buzz cut, the bowl cut.
Oh,
the weird one. The one that no one fucking talks about. Sorry for all you Guy Gardner fans.
Yeah, sorry. I don't know the Green Lantern mythos as well.
It's cool. But Guy Gardner is who I would bring into this movie. And I would have Guy Gardner just say some shit, have him be a lantern. Because I'm saying if you're going to show the core, then go to the core.
Yeah.
Have something go down or like flash to the core. Like,
have movies them are call disjointed in Hal as well. Jordan later.
I like the idea of introducing Guy Gardner and then having the Green Lantern movie, which we know will feature multiple lanterns, have that actually be Jon Stewart and Hal Jordan.
That'd be cool.
The reason why I say to do that is because don't cast your Jon Stewart yet. Wait it out. Because if you cast now, you're casting for a movie in 2020. You're going to cast like a Tyrese or someone, and then it's just like, that guy's not going
to
be famous.
Tyrese Gibson wants to be Green
so bad.
Lantern
and
I swear to
God, if they announce that, like, I will be very upset. He's not a good actor, and like, I don't need him in that movie as that role. No offense to Tyrese. You're cool, man. You want to come on the show sometime?
I mean, he seems like a fun dude to hang with.
Yeah, yeah, come through. You live in Temecula, so.
Does he really?
Yeah, Tyrese lives in Temecula.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
I'm going to go find him one day.
Kind of Randy.
Be like, hey,
Randy?
Dude.
Random. So show Guy Gardner, have him say some shit, talk about the core. Boom. You have Hal Jordan, Jon Stewart, the two that people actually give a fuck about, the two that actually like will intrigue a story, carry a story in a movie sense on a mainstream budget. You have enough time at that point separated from the old Hal Jordan to this Hal Jordan.
Right.
You're not bringing in this guy and saying, this is Hal Jordan, not Ryan Reynolds. And I know Ryan Reynolds is already a different superhero. There's been time, but I think
he's
a little bit more time.
About it too.
The longer you wait, the better it'll be.
Absolutely.
And I think if you bring in Guy Gardner, you're
introducing
the idea. By
2020, it'll already have been 9 years, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But by bringing in Guy Gardner, you're introducing the idea of the core the same way that you would with any other lantern. But what you're doing is you're not like...
You're distancing yourself from... Mm-hmm. Ryan Reynolds.
But you're also building the universe, man. Like,
yeah.
You don't need Guy. Like, you'll never have a movie based around Guy Gardner. I know that.
Right.
But if you just show him there, or like, what if Sinestro is the guy that they bring in?
I was just going to say that.
Sinestro,
do you think they
the
bring
homie?
Back Sinestro?
Yeah, I think Sinestro, you can't have a Green Lantern core movie without Sinestro. I don't know if, I think you should keep Sinestro as good for a while and don't do that lame ass. Like whatever he fucking did at the end of that movie with like the yellow, yellow fucking beam of power. Whatever. I'm
the
sorry.
Yellow beam of power.
Yeah, you can tell.
That's
I totally
I used to call my piss.
Lantern. Yeah, me too. The yellow beam of power. Jesus Christ. Cars 3. What do you think?
Cars, holy fucking shit, dude. First of all, after the commercial and critical failure of the second
Was
Cars?
A commercial failure.
No, I guess not a commercial failure.
Dude, not by any fucking means. You want to hear this number? Cars franchise, take a guess how much money that franchise has made. Toys, merchandising, movies, everything.
I want to say $1.6
billion. $10 billion.
Get the fuck out of here.
You want to know what Star Wars has made since the 70s?
Huh.
Merchandising, movies, toys, everything.
Five?
$12 billion. $2 billion more,
fuck?
And it's been going on for 20 years.
Yeah,
more. So that's why there's a Cars.
Okay, that makes
there's
a lot
no
more sense.
Failure.
Yeah, sorry,
anywhere
not commercial
near,
failure.
Sorry,
is
I just
not
wanted
I
to
meant.
Put that in perspective. Like, it's not even like they're a success. It's like the most successful fucking thing in my Toys R Us that I work
at,
bro.
You know what,
there's 24 feet of Cars. There's nothing else in that whole section other than Star Wars, Marvel, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles that are that much real
that's
estate
obscure.
in the store. Like, there's no... That Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles is actually popping in the toy sense. It's weird.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, that makes sense.
Because of that, that animated television show. They're not really based on the movies. They're not
realistic.
I was going
to say, that's like really obscure for those toys to
they're
be like...
scary looking toys when they're tied into the movies. But then they're friendly when they're tied into the animated series. So.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah.
But yeah, like I'm still surprised that they would have even thought to do
Despite
a Cars 3.
It's still a critical failure.
Yeah.
No one liked Cars 2.
Yeah, critical failure.
Most
and
people
like,
don't even really like Cars 1 when you really think about it.
Fuck that. I love Cars 1.
I love Cars 1.
I love everything Cars 1. That Cars 1 stands for.
I love
the
Cars
message
1.
They're saying. And I mean, even Owen Wilson at the time, he was that guy that was like making shitty movies. And they put
still
him in
does.
Cars. And
still
it was
does.
Like... Still. Is he still making shitty movies?
Yeah, dude. What was that
what
movie
was his,
he
what
just
was his
made?
Last one?
The fucking movie where like the world was ending...
Oh,
like,
no, not the world was ending. It was the war breaking out in No Escape. You didn't like No Escape?
No.
Really?
No.
I thought that was not bad.
I mean, okay, for Owen Wilson pedigree, yes.
No, I mean, like, for a movie. Like, it was a pretty good movie, in my opinion. I thought it was cool.
Yeah, you know. Whatever.
What else we got? We got, holy shit, Shanghai Dawn. That's right. We'll talk about that in a second. Maybe next week or something.
Zoolander 2, Masterminds. Fucking.
Yeah, Masterminds fell apart. No, Masterminds didn't fall apart.
It wasn't that good in Inherent Vice. I didn't like that movie. Night at the Museum. He's just like doing his own
shtick. Night at the Museum is a shtick thing. Yeah. It's like
Internship, not good.
No, that wasn't a good movie.
It wasn't good. I was so ready for you to say that was good.
I laughed at it. It did what it was supposed to, I guess, but it wasn't a good movie.
Midnight in Paris
was good. Yeah. I really liked that one.
It was serviceable.
But Cars 2 was.
That's still the worst, I think.
Hall Pass was awful.
Yeah. Hall Pass was
I wanted
awful.
That movie to be so good.
I wanted that movie. What was it? Screwdriver Bill or something?
No, the fucking...
Drill Bit Taylor. No, that's Drill another... Wait, no, that's another movie that he did called Drill Bit Taylor, but I also saw Hall Pass.
Marley and Me, Say What You Want, dude. That was a good movie. That one makes me cry every time I see
that fucking ending, dude. It'll get you.
Yeah.
Like, talk about movies that were, like, poorly marketed. Like, that and Bridge to Terabithia were just marketed as completely different movies. Like, until you just get fucking hit in the face with that dog.
You know what's nuts, dude? Bridge to Terabithia? I saw that movie in high school because it used to play on HBO all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And, I literally watched it because I had nothing else to watch because I'd seen everything else 100 times because that's how HBO does.
Yeah.
I fucking love Bridge to Terabithia.
It's a great movie. But the way that they marketed that movie was only the imagination side.
Exactly.
Of shit.
And I like when I was watching that movie, I was like, dude, this movie. Or when I was watching the movie, I was like, dude, this movie's fucking. Oh my god, I was never gonna be ready for this. Never. And the trailers, I was watching the trailers, like, dude, what is this kid crap? Like.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
Whatever, man.
Anyway, we went off on a whole different tangent. A
little bit.
Let's go back to Owen Wilson. We were talking about Cars 3.
Cars 3, so the trailer drops. It's basically way more realistic looking. I don't know if they just upped the CGI budget or if they just retooled the whole artwork and stylistic design of the world of Cars, because that was very invigorating and...
It was dark. Almost.
High octane, man.
Yeah. I mean, it looked like...
Well,
this movie reminded me, honestly, not just because it's NASCAR.
It's a 30-second trailer, so it's hard for us to say that this movie is going to be dark. It's not going to be dark.
No, it's not going to be a dark movie. No, I don't mean like that. I just mean that the teaser was dark. Like,
yeah, 100%. But even like in color tone. Even like in color tone. People excited.
Yeah. And I mean, just the way that they said it, too. From now on, nothing will be the same or everything will change.
Yeah, but...
Something like that, like... I know it's the same thing as what you're saying, like how James Gunn would say, like, oh, this is the biggest movie, or Chris Pratt says, this is the biggest movie spectacle you'll ever see, something like that. It's the same sense, like, from now on, nothing's going to change, or nothing's going to be the same. But, like, just the fact that they would do that in a franchise that was a kid franchise, that first Cars, it was more or less, it was a kid's movie, you know, talking cars. They had adult themes of, like, you know, life and change and accepting who you are instead of who you thought you were going to be, stuff like that. But then they had Cars 2, which felt like it was strictly a kid's movie. Like, it was just like, hey, look at this goofy movie. We're parodying James Bond with these talking cars.
Okay, but let me read you the synopsis. And then in comparison to what we just got released to the public.
Okay.
Tell me if this lends credence to that, because I just feel like it's gonna be the same shit. I really don't think there's gonna be much different.
Oh
I
my
think
god,
they,
please don't read me a synopsis that tells me that movie is not what I want to see.
It's not going to be, dude. Oh, there's no way.
Fuck.
Why would you watch Cars 2 and then see that trailer and then just forget about Cars 2? That's why they put out the trailer.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I was hoping.
It's the same team, though.
I was hoping that they're thinking, like, oh, let's put out this trailer and hope that they forget about Cars 2. Maybe we just don't make another Cars 2.
Okay, that's possible.
I was
blindsided by a new generation of fast blazing racers. The legendary Lightning McQueen, voice of Owen Wilson, is suddenly pushed out to the sport. Pushed out of the sport he loves. To get back in the game, he will need the help of an eager young race technician, Cruz Ramirez, with her own plan to win, plus inspiration from the late fabulous Huston Hornet in a few unexpected turns. Proving that number 95 isn't through yet will test the heart of a champion on Piston Cup racing.
That's not as bad as your little preview.
That is it's not Mater going to Europe, So I guess, fuck, if that's the pedigree that we're going to hold Cars to,
that's then not that what makes I'm holding it a great it to, movie. But I'm like,
no, I'm saying in my own opinion. I'm not even comparing to whatever you feel. I'm just saying that this is not what we just watched. They are doing some clickbait within a fucking teaser. Like, you know that in that movie, when he crashes, he may not even fucking crash. It may just be like, well, that could have been shitty, and then cut to some shit, and then true, be like, yeah. Big day, I'm late, or something like that. Dude,
see, in my
there's
head,
so many fucking ways that
in my head
that
crashes the beginning of the movie.
That I hope. Okay, I hope
because of I what you like just said it. There. You know, like he's being pushed out of the
doesn't say
he
he's
loved.
Hurt. First of all, if he crashed like how he crashed,
yeah, no, he would totally be broken. I totally. Well, I mean, it's a car. You can repair a car.
Okay.
Right. In that sense,
touche. Yeah,
and we're talking about NASCARs where their body, the shell is just a.
I've always viewed the world of cars like you get one body. Sorry, that was my bad.
Yeah,
like no. That's like I pictured the tires, the shoes, and then
I picture the tires as like their feet. Mm-hmm. You know, and
I picture never mind.
Okay. The wheel is feet, the tires the shoe. Yeah,
but that. I always thought you could just die in cars. Like, you can't service. They can't just replace the engine. Like, or is that like a heart transplant? I don't know. Fuck.
Man. Well, that's what I mean. Like, I don't think that they're.
I think we're getting into like the history.
Yeah, we're getting into the like the biology of a car. But anyway, no. What I'm saying is like the way that she was joking with him in the first one. Oh, hey, stickers. You know that. You know, his lights, they're not real. His body, it's not real because he's this fake, this mannequin of superstardom, you know? Mm-hmm. And his body not being real, I mean, maybe it's not what they were going for, but in my head, just hearing it right now, it makes me think of, you know, the cellulite queens of Los Angeles who get like plastic surgery all fucking day until it's like, your body isn't real anymore. Same thing with Lightning McQueen. He is that Los Angeles, you know, that superstar in the heart of or in the public eye, you know. His body's not real in the same sense that those people's bodies aren't real. So they can't replace it after it gets damaged. They can repair it. He can repair his the same way a NASCAR gets replaced or repaired.
Gotcha.
The body of a NASCAR is just a fiberglass shell.
Yeah, I mean...
So I see this from that plot synopsis. I see Lightning McQueen in a big race in the beginning of the movie. We see that fucking black car that looks like some kind of Batmobile zooming up through the middle of all these other cars. That car somehow it gets close to Lightning McQueen. It takes him out of the race, and you see that like how they had it. And I fucking dig that teaser because I'm really hoping it's as good of a movie as the teaser looked.
I just think that teaser is just the greatest form of rhetoric that you've ever seen. Like, they literally just brainwashed the entire news media and movies. Like, literally everyone is just so hyped about Cars 3 now. And it's just like, bro,
and if you're
saw 30 seconds with zero dialogue other than the fact that it says nothing will be the same, which is the most fucking cliche thing I've ever fucking read on a movie.
Right. No. And I agree with you. And if you're right, then they fucking, it worked on me.
No, but that's the problem is like I just want to
I hope that you're not right in the sense that like I hope that they're not trying to do that because
like
one
the
because then
that,
if,
like
if they are doing that then I'm literally falling for it
if I had
like,
asked
right
you last
here,
week
on
how you feel
recording.
About Cars 3 you would have said fucking nothing.
I would have been
but
like dude why
like
are
that,
you making
that,
Cars 3
that thing with this is nothing to do with the plot nothing to do with the character development nothing to do with
well,
any dialogue
we don't know that yet.
That no, I can firmly say that teaser trailer had nothing to do with the plot. That told me nothing about the story of Cars 3 is what I'm saying. What? As a service, you may say that, oh, well, we'll have context to the scene. That's not what I'm saying.
No. I mean,
that is
that,
a sole clip.
Yeah, no,
anything.
It's just a clip, and it doesn't
you don't
tell
even
you.
See Lightning McQueen's face. You don't even see his eyes.
Yeah,
you don't even know if
eyes,
that's really Lightning
well,
McQueen.
Well, you see his eyes like, fuck. And no, you know it's Lightning McQueen because the announcer at the end, like right before he crashes,
you know what I mean. I'm not literally saying that that's not Lightning McQueen. I'm saying that we don't know anything from this movie clip and that people are taking this because it's a fucking new art direction and a little bit more gritty, octane, a little bit of a tone.
I get that.
Is that a tone piece? What is that?
No, I get what you're saying. It's 30 seconds of a movie that we haven't seen yet, so we can't like say anything of it. But from the plot synopsis that was just given, I mean, you can kind of put together that maybe... Maybe. I mean, everything's a maybe. It's a teaser.
Yeah.
So maybe that car comes up in the middle. It's that new, younger, fucking way badass car that he's talking about. It's basically like in the beginning of Cars 1 when Lightning McQueen was the badass car, taking, like, not taking out the older cars, but, you know, he's too much for the older cars. Now he's the older car, and he's experiencing what it was like to be the older car in his sense. And he's dealing with, like, a young Chuck, whatever the fuck, that was taken over, you know, Thunder, Kachiga.
Yeah.
You know? Maybe. I mean, maybe. And maybe it's a good movie in that sense. I don't think seeing this trailer or this teaser trailer that looks really good, I don't think that just because it looks so good and it looks different, we should say, oh, because Cars 2 wasn't good at all, we should disregard how good this teaser looks.
I never said that this wasn't a good teaser.
No, I know.
This movie isn't going to be good. I'm calling it now. This is not a representation of any movie that we've ever seen. There's nothing to take away from this other than the fact that they have a new art direction. They're going for a more grittier tone if this is a tone piece. Or this is just something that they cut away from and it's a bad dream. That's what I'm saying,
yeah,
dude.
I get that.
They can
completely
fuck us all over again. And that this is just pure rhetoric at its finest form, saying that, like, let's do the exact opposite of what people have the idea of what the car franchise is, just to get the buzz, and now people are excited. Whether or not that's worth it or not worth it, but you have to take into the idea that Cars 3 wouldn't be made if they didn't make as much money as they did on merchandising.
Absolutely.
So despite what story is being told, in the end, it's to sell toys, man. Like, that's why they make these movies, to add other cars to sell on the fucking shelves. And despite that fact that you can't go away from, that is indisputable by the fact that 10 billion sales since 2005? That's absurd, dude. That's a huge franchise that you can't just ignore, and you can't just stop it. And I feel like that, with this weird trailer that came out, it's just like, I don't know, man. I feel like they're doing what you said, is that you said it was a critical and commercial failure. It wasn't a commercial failure, and they're trying to make this one not a critical failure. And the way that you start that is by brainwashing your audience. That's the only point I was making. I'm not trying to comment on, like, the plot or, like, how you feel about it. I'm sorry. I feel like we went down this way big rabbit hole. But the point that I'm making is that this is the movie to sell toys until they show me something to
right,
do with
but
the
if,
plot.
But if it's a good movie, is that not okay?
Yeah, of course. But how are you going to even... By saying it's a
I'm
good
not,
movie
no,
based
not,
off this 50
I'm
seconds...
I'm not saying that it's a good movie based off of this 50 seconds.
I didn't say... No, that's not what I'm saying. By saying that, if someone were to say that, it's no different than me saying that this is probably going to be a bad movie off of that 50 seconds.
Right,
so
right.
So just going down a rabbit hole of nothing.
No, I get that. But I'm not. I'm just saying, like, because, like, it sounds like to me that you're saying, like, they shouldn't make this movie because the only reason to make this movie is to sell toys.
No, I'm saying the only reason they are making this movie, and if you are Pixar, you should make this movie to make money, because that's what they are in for, the business, not to make a quality fucking film. They're here to make money. That's how I feel.
Doesn't that contradict what Andrew Stanton was saying in the interview, though, earlier before, where he was talking about, like, we're not going to do something just because it's what the public wants. We'll do it if we think it's a good idea.
$10 billion in sales, Kyle. No one fucking liked Cars 2. You don't make another Cars if no one likes it. That doesn't make any sense. I'm saying that, yeah, he feels
like,
that way.
But, what if a good idea came along?
This one car movie will fucking pay the bills so that they can
make a
billion fucking Inside
that,
Out.
But, I mean, like, are you telling me now that there is no chance that this is a good movie?
No, what the fuck? No, what are you talking about? I said, in my opinion, I don't think this is going to be a good movie based off of the track record of the other one.
Right.
That's all I said.
So, okay, so you don't think it's going to be a good
movie? That's
why
I'm saying you're going down. I feel like you're taking this too far.
I'm just trying to understand what
you're
saying.
No, you're trying to put words in my mouth.
No.
Let's just go on to a different topic.
No. I want to know what you're saying, because, like,
I can't explain it anymore. We've been talking about this for 20 minutes now. Like, I literally can't explain it any better than how I just did. That's my opinion. I don't know.
Well, because I know, but the reason I ask is because I know that you're not the type of person to be like, this movie is gonna suck, hands down.
That's not what I fucking said, Kyle. If that's
I know,
what you're
no, I get that,
me,
and that's
then.
No. That's what I'm saying is I'm not taking that away from you, but that's like, or I'm taking that away from this conversation, but I'm trying not to because I know that that's not what you would say.
It doesn't matter. It's not something that I'm really that passionate about to where I'm going to stay here for another 20 trying to explain to you and make this like an hour and 40 minute podcast.
Okay.
Yeah. I just don't see like the point in that. I just feel like there's no, I feel like we hit an impasse, but if you want to talk about this upcoming week in releases, we could do that.
Yeah, let's bring up the new releases this week.
Let's do it. Fucking, what is coming out? I don't even know.
We've Moana. Got Mulan. Oh, that's right, Mulan.
Mulan.
No, no, I'm like Mulan.
Back in theaters for 1 week only. Bad Santa 2. I'd go see it. Is this true?
Bad Santa 2. No, this. There's no way this is right. Didn't Shut In already come out?
That's not. Yeah, never mind. Shut In already came out.
Yeah,
but you're reading from left to right to left.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You're supposed to read left to right.
Yeah.
Allied, they were Bad all on Santa 2, Moana, Rules Don't Apply. It was from most recent to least recent. Rules Don't Apply and Dear Zindagi. What is your pick, Kyle?
I don't know. Fantastic Beasts.
Oh, that's your pick out of these new releases.
No, oh, I thought you meant like for number one, like.
Or, oh no, no, no! I was saying, what's your pick of the week for like these new releases? Like, if you had to go pick a.
What I want to see the most, I guess, Allied.
Oh, okay.
Allied, yeah, actually, Allied for sure, and then probably Bad Santa 2. I feel like I shouldn't want to see that because it's like it's just the typical 10 year later fucking sequel.
Yeah.
But, you know, I guess if I'm picking a second one out of those, I don't want to see Moana that much. I mean, I'll probably end up seeing it sometime later, but
yeah.
There's just nothing about it that's like, hey, Kyle, you should definitely see this. Like, this is a movie you would love. Like, gotcha. I don't see that.
Hey, you say it's not for you.
But I don't think it would be a bad movie in that sense. I don't have. It's like going back and being like, oh yeah, would you want to see the animated Beauty and the Beast when it comes out, or would you rather see The Matrix?
True.
Not that those opened on the same weekend, but you know.
Yeah,
around the same era,
for sure. You gotta pick your picks.
Yes, Fantastic Beast is gonna be number one again for sure. I feel like this is a bold prediction, but I think Fantastic Beast actually makes more next weekend than it did this weekend.
Impossible.
Is that stupid?
Literally.
Is impossible. That stupid?
That is the stupidest thing you've said on this podcast today. Sorry. I
don't know why.
I will eat my shoe. I will literally put this shoe, which is pretty. No, I'll take my work shoes and I'll put them both in my mouth on air if that happens. Because it won't. There's no fucking way.
I don't know why in my head I feel like that would happen.
That would put the movie at 150 at least in 2 weeks. How does that make sense? Like that there's no way.
In my head it doesn't make sense, but like at the same time I feel like a lot of people didn't see it this weekend and they're going to hear a lot of people be like, "Dude, that movie was so good. You have to see it." And then also those people who did see it and are telling those people who didn't see it, they're going to go and see it with them.
Yeah.
That's the only reason I think that it would go up, but I
say you're wrong because you're the highest I've heard anyone be about this movie. So like to
that's
put it
true.
In frame.
I haven't
like,
heard anyone else talk no. about the movie yet too. They, so that's like.
They say it's good. No one says it's a bad movie.
Yeah,
it's just
no,
like
no.
Everyone says it's like a 6 or 7, but you say it's like an 8 or 9, it sounds like.
Yeah, I would give it like an 8.5 or 9.
We can't. We can't
right.
spoil the
I
review.
I forgot.
Can't spoil the review.
But anyway, no, yeah.
I didn't mean to cover your mouth.
No, no, no. That was so mom-ish. That was like, don't do honey.
My reactions, though, I should probably have some kids. Not fuck that. What do you got for 2 through 5?
I'm going to say.
Keep in mind our new releases.
I mean, fuck, dude. I don't think Allied is going to be top 5. I want it to be just from like the trailer I saw, but I don't know. Maybe Doctor Strange will take 2 again. I see Moana taking 3, pushing Trolls out of the top 5 since it's going to be the new kid hit movie.
Yeah, I didn't think about that when I was talking about Trolls earlier.
I think, yeah, Moana's at 3. I'd say Arrival at 4 and Bad Santa at 5. Bad Santa 2 at 5. This is a tough week.
Yeah, it's a little bit of an interesting. So Moana's going to be 1.
You think Moana 1?
By far. There's no way. I would say Moana 1, Fantastic Beasts 2. It's got to be Doctor Strange at 3. Arrival. Nah. Something else has got to. Dude, but like, how big of a release is Bad Santa going to have?
I think
I've heard zero buzz. Well, I've just heard no buzz is my point.
Oh, the only buzz that I really hear on this one is like everyone's like, oh my God, that new Red Band trailer, blah, blah, blah. But
you know,
like,
maybe they'll grab the Thanksgiving audience.
Maybe.
See, I don't know where we do the weekend box office next week, considering that every movie opens on Wednesday. Is it just the first 3-day opening or is it the weekend? because
that
takes away from certain shit.
Also gives them like 5 days.
That'll be my research. Yeah, that'll be my research to like, because I know you do count the 4-day weekend, just because you don't want to nitpick 3 to 4 days, and it's easier to do so, but. 5 days. No, that's like six almost too.
That's true.
Because if you open on Tuesday, right?
Do they open tonight? Anywhere? Let's check.
I don't know. Yeah. So coming in at so 1 Moana, 2 Fantastic Beasts, 3 Doctor Strange, 4. Yeah, it's playing today, tonight. Moana is. Yeah. So starting today, Tuesday, through Sunday is like a weekend. And that's like not a weekend. You know what I mean? So we got to cut it off at some point, but I don't know when. So we'll get back to y'all.
Yeah, that's the thing is if they do count the whole like break as their opening weekend, one, that's kind of fucked up because that fucks with all record keeping and like stats as far as like
what there's a regulation. It'll be a 3-day haul, but I don't know where the 3 days is. That was the point.
You don't think it'll be a 4-day haul?
It could be a 4-day haul, but like even that's weird. Like are you counting? You must be counting Thursday to Sunday, right?
But then that fucks up because if anyone sees it tonight, and that tonight's the opening night.
Yeah.
So.
Well, yeah, I think you would count Thursday because it's the holiday, and that's the point of opening it on the Thursday. It's like that's why you open it up for that time period. You don't open it on Friday. You get it open on Wednesday to have people come in on Thursday to go and see the movie like some weird families do on Thanksgiving. No offense if your family does that. Wait, I need to finish my topic.
Oh, right. Sorry.
See, I'm in between Almost Christmas taking it.
Versus Allied or versus Bad Santa?
No, taking 4 or 5.
Oh.
Like, I don't even think
Almost
Bad Santa.
Almost Christmas is at 5 already, so they're not going to go to 4. I don't think.
What do you mean?
You think Almost Christmas would move up from 5 to 4?
Yeah, because I think that the scale of numbers, I think it's going to be like, I think 4 will be at 5 million by the time you have like, Moana is going to make what? $80 to $100 million? Easy? The Rock, dude. The Rock. The Rock on a fucking family like extravaganza time of like week.
When was the last time he did that? The Tooth Fairy?
What do you mean?
A family movie?
I mean, The Rock's movies just turn into family movies. Oh. I feel like I think just a
Fast
lot
and
of
the
what
Furious
he
definitely
does.
Turned into a family movie.
Ah, family, bro. That's the whole point of the movie. yeah. All right. You know what? I'm gonna put Allied at 4 and Arrival at 5.
Okay.
I just took all Christmas movies out of the mix. So Moana at 1, Fantastic Beasts 2, Doctor Strange 3, Allied at 4, Arrival 5. What do you got? What was your shit? It was Fantastic Beasts.
It was Fantastic Beasts, Doctor Strange.
Moana.
Wow, fuck, man. Now I'm thinking about it.
Well, we gotta go.
Fantastic Beasts, Moana, Doctor Strange, Arrival, Allied.
All right.
All right, that's been After the Previews this week. You can find Garrett on Twitter.
We went a little long
Twitter.
With that Cars discussion, but you know,
yeah,
we'll have the trivia next week.
Oh, shit, that's right. I totally forgot about Games with Garrett. Sorry, I lied to you before the intro.
Yeah, no Games with Garrett. Bitches.
Whatever. It wasn't topical, so it's okay. We can literally do it whenever we want.
All right.
It's a fun one, too.
Nice.
Anyway, that's been After the Previews. Garrett, where can they find you?
You can find me on Twitter at YoGert on Twitter, YoGRRTT. Go over to ConstantRotation.com starting December 1st, and you can find many articles by myself and as well as Kyle. Every Wednesday, And Games Podcast. Every Tuesday, In Rotation Conversations. Every Monday, In Rotation Compilations. And you can find the latter two only on SoundCloud.com/ConstantRotation.
Guess what? You've been keeping up with all our news on Facebook and shit. Mm-hmm. That's great.
We appreciate
and
you.
We really do appreciate that. I mean, like a lot.
Yeah.
And if you want to keep up on Facebook, we'll still have links there. But if you want to be fucking awesome even more than you already are, because, I mean, you're listening to this. That's fucking rad. And you're at the end of the episode listening to this. That's even more rad. If you want to keep being awesome, head over to constantrotation.com/afterthepreviewsblog within the next couple weeks or so.
Or just /news/afterthepreviews, either
one. Yeah, all that. I mean, check out the Constant Rotation website. I mean, You don't have to stay on after the previews either. You can check out all the video game stuff. You can check out all the music stuff with local.
If we do our job correctly,
yeah,
hopefully that happens.
But yeah, check out, keep up with the constantrotation.com, everything that's going on there. We're doing a lot to build that website right now. And all the news that I've been posting on Facebook, you can see on Constant Rotation now. Well, not now, because I'm still...
The internet's a flat circle, dude. Someone could be hearing this December 2nd, and they'll be like, oh my God, starting yesterday, this happened. Like, yeah, now, motherfuckers.
That's right. So yeah, ConstantRotation.com. Check it out there. That's where you're going to find me, because I honestly, I don't have a lot of internet presence these days. Twitter, Instagram kind of fell off. I got like one a week.
Time for a big boy presence, dog. Big boy content producer.
Right? I got to.
Don't be tweeting about your...
I thought you meant like big boy presence, like as in gifts presence. I was like, what's a big boy present? Like,
what are you... Tampons.
Am I getting something?
Tampons, condoms.
You know. I can definitely use the first one.
Other contraceptives.
I don't think a tampon's a contraceptive.
Dude, yeah, it is. If she has to use one, she's not pregnant. Hey, well, that's been After the Preview.
Thanks for listening to After the Previews. Please shut off your cell phone.